chances are you're only 1 to 2 key hires away from completely unlocking growth in your real estate investing business. But if you're like most investors, you probably don't know who your next hire needs to be. And that's exactly what we're going to talk about in today's video. Hey, Josh Ayers here with REI BlackBook. And if you're new to our channel, make sure that you hit subscribe and also hit the bell icon so you get notified when we release videos like this. And in today's video, we've got a recording from one of our previous REI bootcamp events where Damon Remy, the CEO of REI BlackBook, goes through and talks about how to build a seeding chart for your real estate investing business. He specifically talks about how to do this for a wholesale business, but the same idea and concept works for any type of business, but certainly any type of real estate investing business. Now, if you've ever read the book Traction, this concept is probably familiar with you, but Damon takes the concept and he makes it specific for a real estate investing business. And so it's really important when you're going to hire a team member and build a team to have a vision for what you want your team to be and to understand all of the different departments and all of the seats that you need to fill in your business. And this concept works whether you're looking to hire full-time employees that actually sit in your office or virtual assistants or contractors or even agencies that are gonna help you with certain tasks, whether it be on a task-to-task basis or maybe just on a monthly or weekly basis. Hiring and building a team is one of the most important things that you can do as a business owner. And in this video, you're gonna learn how to do just that. So with that said, let's get into the video.
The next thing we wanna talk about is the seating chart, right? Now, in the book Traction, they talk about this as an accountability chart. I just call it the seating chart, right? People planner, however you want to think about this, but it is not an org chart. Even though the structure is going to look like an org chart, it is not an organizational chart. Okay, it is truly what we call, how do I ensure the roles? Okay, so. Instead of saying how many people do I have on my team, I have to say what are all the functions that have to happen in my business in order for my business to operate, right? So when we were talking to Scott earlier and he's like, man, I'm really struggling with being able to kind of let go and to have this thing run without me, okay? There's a lot of reasons for that. Sometimes it's our own ego, okay? Sometimes it's our own ego. I know in my personal situation, it was definitely the significance factor, right? I want to be the man. I want to be unique, right? I want to be the CEO kind of thing. So to let go, it was really hard, okay? But also I couldn't let go unless I knew I had the right structure in place. So now if you look at my behavioral profile today, you'll see that and you guys saw it, right? That's myself, right? That's naturally who I am, such far gaps, right? And I know it's extreme, but if I showed you my self-concept, a lot of those have completely flip-flopped and changed because I'm very consciously right now turning over everything I possibly can to my team, right? I really want them to take it and run with it. And it's a little bit foreign because I've said that before, but my actions did not support my words, okay? So I said, hey, Josh, I really want you to take the marketing department and run with it, man. And then he would start, and then I would come in and tell him everything he's doing wrong, and hey, here's how you do it, right? There's only so long that people can take that, by the way, okay? So the words that I keep telling them, and now they can see it even in the behavioral profile of like, hey, no, man, I'm really committed to this. It's only gonna be so good if I continue the actions to support it, right? And it's admittedly hard, but I've gotta let go to grow. All right, so we're gonna put the seating chart together. This is gonna be all the functions. What are the functions that have to happen in your business? And then we're gonna tie the scorecard with it and say, okay, well, here's how we build out a scorecard to measure the success objectively for each department and really honestly each seat. At that point, we're gonna take all of the right people, right? So we now know we got the right people. Let's go ahead, let's look at their behavior profile, right? Let's look at their skill set. They're value-based, right? The interviewing, they shouldn't be on the team if they don't have the aligned values, okay? So that's the first thing that they gotta go, okay? If they're not aligned values. But now we got clear on their behavioral profile, we're clear on their skill set, that's then gonna tell us where do they sit on the bus. And again, you're gonna have people sitting in multiple seats, right? And I'll share with you guys a little bit my accountability chart today, and we'll kind of walk through the process of building building the seating chart, this is going to be something you need to do. And we're going to give you, again, I'm going to give you a copy of a seating chart that we basically built out for real estate investing team. And you're going to see, and I will share it, we'll go over that as well. But let's kind of walk through the process of building this thing as we bring this up. So let me get logged in. I personally, just so everybody knows, I use a tool called Lucid Charts, LucidChart.com. My team can probably post a link to that, to Lucid Charts. I build, it's basically just a diagramming software that we build all kinds of diagrams and workflow maps and all that stuff. It's really just visually, okay? And so I'm gonna go ahead and open this up. And actually, before I show this on the screen, I'm gonna go to the whiteboard real quick, okay? And I'm gonna talk about the basic elements here of the seating chart, okay? Now, there's a really good book called Rocket Fuel. Is it Rocket Fuel that does the traction of Visionary? Yeah. Is that the one I had you guys read?
It talks about the Visionary and the Integrator.
Yeah. So go get the book, Rocket Fuel. It's Gino Wickman. All right, so Rocket Fuel by Gino Wickman. It's gonna talk about two key roles in your organization. This is actually what I'd mentioned to Scott. Scott, I would encourage you to go read that book as well. But go read that book. It's called Rocket Fuel. And it really describes two very distinct roles in your organization. One is what we call the visionary, and the second is what we call the integrator, okay? So I remember, quite frankly, before we started diving in, in the last 12 months, diving really hard into predictive index, diving in to my own human needs, doing a lot of self-evaluation, the kind of the personal growth that I've been really looking for, as well as, the crazy thing is that also leads into professional growth. I got to tell you, I think my team was probably on the verge of breaking up, right? We were not very healthy, and it was becoming very, very frustrating. I know I was frustrated, and I can only imagine that my what I call my leadership team was becoming frustrated as well. So every week we would have these leadership meetings, and I would come in, completely dominate, tell them blah, 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 scream and yell, get all crazy, and it was not very productive. They, quite frankly, they didn't ever say much because, I would always challenge it and push back. But then I got to the point where I'm like, holy crap. Like, seriously, like, why do we have these meetings if you guys aren't going to provide, candid feedback and open, honest communication? And eventually we kind of had a breakthrough, and Rocket Fuel was really that breakthrough. Okay. So I went and reread Rocket Fuel. And all I needed to read was two chapters. One chapter was on the visionary, one chapter was on the integrator. And when I read the visionary, okay, the first part of that chapter, it made me feel like a rock star, right? It talks about all of these amazing qualities of what a visionary looks like, right? So the ability to come in and dream big, right? To dream big, you have new ideas, 10 new ideas a week, right? You can pivot on a dime, right? You don't need all the structure, all of these things. And I'm like, that's what makes me a great visionary. I can see, right? You can pivot, new ideas, all this stuff. And so that sounded great, right? And I'm like, I'm coming into my team all the time, and I'm like, hey guys, I know we said we're gonna do this, but man, I just thought about this. So we're gonna pivot, right? And I didn't realize, I know it sounds obvious, man, but and because I'd been teaching this stuff for so long, but again, I didn't have an integrator for a long period of time. And even myself teaching this stuff and doing it, sometimes there's that problem right here that you can't see. And I honestly thought that my team loved me because I come up with all these great ideas all the time, right? For those of you that are on the team right now in the chat box, tell me, was I correct in the fact that you guys love that I come up with new ideas all the time and change the direction every other day? Does anybody love that? I would be shocked if anybody says yes, and they can be completely transparent and honest, but it sucked, right? So part of what that Rocket Fuel, that chapter about a visionary, says, hey, these are all these great qualities that you have, but these are all of the weaknesses. And this is the kryptonite, right? And as I read that, I was like, oh God, this is how my team sees me. This is how my team sees me. This is why they are so frustrated, because all of these strengths that I think I have really are translating to absolute weaknesses, and it's kryptonite and it's tearing my team apart. And I didn't know that. I didn't really recognize it for a long period of time, and then finally reread that and I was like, okay, this is it. Right? And then I read the part on the integrator. And if you really want to think about visionary integrator, it's a typical CEO type role. That's the visionary role, right? They're responsible for ultimately the vision, right? The people, right? And typically, you know, big relationships and raising capital. Right? That's really what a visionary is typically responsible for, okay? And so I'm good at those things. I was focused on those things all the time. But I didn't have what we call the operator, right? So the CEO, visionary, that's the you know, that visionary seat. But typically they're really terrible at implementing and executing, right? They're terrible at the structure. They're terrible at staying focused and prioritizing and managing the daily operations, okay? So that's where, if you go to a publicly traded company or anything like that, you would see a COO type role, okay? So for Facebook, for instance, right? Think about Mark Zuckerberg, right? He's definitely a visionary. And I know some could argue that, but like, wait a minute, wasn't it the Winklevoss twins or whatever their damn name is that really thought of Facebook, right? So, you know, but honestly, like, he is the visionary. He truly is, okay? He's the visionary. And where Facebook had amazingly explosive growth, absolutely amazingly explosive growth, is whenever they brought in Sheryl Sandberg, right? She's the COO, okay? So he's out dreaming it, and then she comes in and make sure that it happens, right? So she executes to make sure that his vision becomes reality, right? And it allows that visionary to continue dreaming, to continue coming up with those new ideas, but they are also, that COO is the buffer to the rest of the team, because you're gonna come in and say, hey man, I just thought of this, and then he's like, hey, cool. We're gonna take that, we're gonna write it right over here. This is gonna be in the good idea book, which is about this thick right now. So we got all of these good ideas, but hey, you had this good idea, and we gotta make money with that first. We gotta execute, we gotta implement. Let's get that done, and then we're gonna come back to the good idea book, and now we're gonna evaluate that, we're gonna prioritize, and then we're gonna identify what's the next good idea we tackle once we execute this good idea, right? That's the kind of the dynamics between a visionary and an integrator. Okay, visionary and integrator, right? And so I basically had my team come in and read Rocket Fuel again, and they all came in. I remember Josh specifically. Josh, I'd be happy for you to throw the chat in the chat box, like whenever you read it, because he came in and was like, "Dude, I think somebody wrote a book about you." Like specifically all the negative shit here, by the way. These pages, that this is you, right? He's like, "Dude, it's this so crazy how they pegged you." And I was like, well, no, man, it's just not just me. I mean, and honestly, it was really kind of, I think, a good opportunity for Josh and I to kind of improve our relationship. Not like it was a bad relationship at the time, but I guarantee it was strained. Whether he would verbally admit that right now or not, I know it was, right? But I think it was at least a step in the right direction for him to see, okay, this is somewhat normal. Other companies have gone through this. We can go through it and we can fix it too, okay? So the answer for us was to bring in an integrator, right? So I needed to bring in that COO seat to kind of insulate the rest of the team a little bit from myself, all right? So the first two seats that you're gonna start off with on your chart, right? This is the bus. This is the seating chart. Where's everybody gonna sit on the bus, okay? Where are you gonna sit on the bus? And honestly, if you think about the bus, like look, straight up, the visionary, I'm just setting the destination. I'm just setting the destination. The integrator, is driving the bus, okay? They're driving the bus. Now, admittedly, look, the truth of it is, some of you have to be visionary and integrator both right now. I know I did it for years, okay? And I once or twice stepped outside and hired an integrator, and I honestly didn't use the PI stuff. I didn't do value-based interviewing. I didn't do a lot of that stuff, and I just, it didn't work out. I didn't have the right COO, okay? So some of you right now, admittedly, yes, you're both visionary and integrator. I get it. But it's gonna be really important for you to distinguish. Now, some of you partners, by the way, you know, some of you may have a partner, some of you may have a spouse, and it can be really clear of who the visionary is and who the integrator is, right? And then, yet, some of you are like, man, I got a little bit of visionary tendency, and I got a little bit of integrator. And you know, again, you can go online. I think it's, if you search EOS visionary test or something like that, you can just Google it. We could probably find it and throw a link in the chat box. Go take that test. You won't take it, maybe take it at lunch, and it'll tell you how strong of a visionary or integrator you are, okay? It'll tell you, I had everybody on my leadership take it so that we could kind of see where they are. And some of them, and looks, you may not be high on either one of them, okay? To Scott's point, again, your natural behavior, like there's a lot of things that go into this, and maybe you're a strong visionary, maybe you're a strong integrator, maybe you're neither. But it's important to understand that, because look, these are seats on the bus. If you truly want to build a business, then you need to get clarity. I'm going to tell you though, if you're starting a business, most of you at least have that insight to be that visionary already, okay? So those are going to be the first two seats on the bus, right? The visionary is basically going to set the destination. Where the heck are we going? They're the big picture, the big thinker, right? All right, now again, daily roles, what else are you doing? Okay, you're building up the people, you're setting, you know, the values, you're defining the values, you know, you're really clearly creating the mission, the values, and the purpose, right? You're gonna maintain big relationships, and then you're ultimately gonna raise capital. I mean, those are typically the big responsibilities of the visionary, okay? And then the integrator, look, they're gonna be driving the bus. They're gonna be operating the business on a daily basis, executing, right? They're running meetings, they're managing meetings, they see all of the different projects, and we're gonna get into the different department levels, and they start making sure, we call them an integrator, to make sure the marketing team is clear what the ops team is doing so that it all kind of works in harmony, okay? That's the job of this integrator, super, super important seat, okay? And again, a lot of terms for these, right? You might see this as labeled as the CEO, and this would be the COO, okay? That might be some common terms, okay? Now what we wanna do is there's four departments that I guarantee you every business has, all right? There's four departments that every business has. First is the marketing. Next is sales. Now, some people will put sales and marketing together, but me personally, I think they're completely different. I know they're completely different. Marketing's job is to generate leads. Sales' job is to convert leads, okay? So marketing and sales. Now, is it a powerful 1-2 relationship? Yes, absolutely. On my team, Josh leads my marketing team. Kevin leads my sales team. Those guys have to have a harmonious relationship, all right? They meet on a more regular basis, even outside of the leadership meeting. They're in constant communication and chatting, okay? But we've got the sales team, we've got the marketing team. Now, once you have a marketing, you have sales, okay? Well, typically, we're gonna move over here. And now, once we've marketed the product, we've sold the product, now we have an ops department. So that's the operations. That actually delivers the widget, that builds the product, that buys the house, that closes the transaction, right? So all of that stuff happens, rehabs the property, does all of those things. That would typically be in your operations. And then finally, the last one over here is your accounting and admin. Really your admin, which handles your accounting, your HR, all of that, okay? Every single business has these four departments, okay? And again, some people put sales and marketing in one. And it always, this is the age-old argument, right? Which one's most important? So which one do you guys think is most important? I'm gonna look in the chat box. Which one's the most important? All right. Some say sales, some say marketing, sales. Visionary, all of them, it's like a hand, they all are. Integrator, marketing to great leads, sales to close, integrator. Okay, it was a trick question. None of them are important, okay? None of them are more important than the other, okay? None of them are more important. So let's say our sales and marketing is really strong. Our sales and marketing is super strong, man. We got a great sales team, we got a great marketing team, we're generating leads, we're closing leads, but our operations department is terrible. We got a really strong accounting and admin department. But if that's the case, what happens? What's the result of having a really strong sales and marketing department? Our ops sucks. We can't deliver the product, right? We can't build the product. We can't perform whatever it is. We can't deliver on the promise of the product or service that we sold. What happens in that situation? Okay? Doesn't matter how much I can sell if I can't deliver it. Okay? You're going to get a shit ton of returns and cancellations or contracts not closing, right? Okay? So that's what's going to happen. Now, if I've got a super strong operations team, a super strong accounting team, but I have a sales and marketing team that's not doing anything, like they're not strong, what do you think happens then? We got the best product on the planet that nobody knows about. And we got an accounting department twiddling their thumbs because there's no products being sold, so there's nothing to count. There's no money to count. There's no beans, right? Okay, vice versa. If I've got an accounting department that's weak, but I got a really strong sales and marketing team, I really got a really strong operations team, but yet my accounting, my admin, basically, you know, that's the administrative systems that we kind of talked about. Now, all of a sudden, what's going to happen is you may be selling a lot, you may be marketing, converting leads, selling a lot, you're delivering, but you have no idea, are you making money or not? You have no idea, are you making money? Where quality, efficiencies, margins, you have no clue. Where do you put capital? Maybe we've got capital that's sitting in an account, it's not being leveraged. You got all kinds of challenges with that. I literally had a meeting with a young man. He actually just signed up for Fast Track, but he's on track to doing $1 million, okay? He literally sat in my office just on last week, and he's like, hey, man, I'm excited, man. I'm on track to do like $1 million this year. Things are rocking and rolling. I was like, okay, cool, man. So like, you know, kind of go through some basic questions. And he had no clue whether he was going to make money or not. So is it cool to make $1 million and not know if you're even freaking making a profit? Okay. So all of these are equally important. Now look, straight up, without a visionary, you probably don't even have a business or a company in the first place, right? Now you can't have a visionary that may not have an integrator, which, you know, sounded like what Scott's doing. So you constantly got the visionary that's having to jump back in and do all of these different roles, right? And look, as a visionary, you're probably a pretty talented person, right? You're probably a pretty talented person. So you can jump in and you can adapt and you can do these types of things. And you probably got a little bit of uncertainty in you anyways. That's a big need. So you want to do that anyways. You don't want to get stuck in doing one particular thing. But yeah, so visionary, you probably wouldn't have a company if you didn't have a visionary. I have seen lots of companies operating without an integrator. It's probably one of the most important seats you can fill. It may not be the first seat, obviously, because, hey, look, you know, finances and just the economy, right? You may not be able to afford that type role, okay? That's going to be very important, all right? So now this is the basic departments, okay? Now what I want you guys to do, and before I even show you guys the accountability chart, I want you to think about your real estate business or whatever business. Let me also be very clear, guys. I honestly, if you want to come in and build a widget and that's what you want to join Fast Track for, look, we've got other business owners in there, and the methodologies and the processes, I don't care if you're building a widget business, a service business, a real estate business, doesn't matter. I'm telling you, vision, people, systems. It's gonna apply to any business, okay? It's gonna apply to any business. In fact, some of you may be operating a business that's generating cash today, but you're miserable and you don't enjoy it, but you still need that to operate and run to fund your real estate stuff. Well, come in, join the Fast Track program. Let's apply the vision, people, and systems to that existing business. Let's get that cash cow generating money. Remember Joe, Cowboy Joe? It's exactly what we did for him. It's like, hey, look, I know you want to do this. I know you want to build this, but let's systemize the current infrastructure that you have. Let's get a plan in place so that can keep generating cash that allows you to go invest in real estate. All right. So sometimes we got to slow down to go fast. All right. So what I want you to do right now is I want you to think about the different functional departments in your real estate business, okay? So this is the basics, by the way. But what's gonna be different for your business, all right? So operations, what does that really look like? And some of you may say, hey, nope, this is good right here. This structure right here is good. But now what we wanna do is under the marketing department, there's gonna be additional seats under the marketing department. Now that's gonna be different for each of you, all right? It's gonna be different for each of you based upon the your marketing strategy and the tactics that you choose, all right? And some of you may not have clearly defined your marketing strategy and the tactics yet, and that's okay. I'm gonna give you a little bit of a cheat sheet, but in your seating chart, now under the marketing team, we wanna sit there and say, okay, what are the different seats that we need on the marketing, okay? Do we need copywriting, right? Do we need a designer? Are we gonna be running, you know, Facebook ads? Do we need, somebody to run our Facebook ads? Are we gonna do pay-per-click? Are we gonna do SEO? What are the functions that I need to operate the marketing department based upon your strategy and tactics, okay? So based upon your strategy and tactics, what are the additional roles? What are the additional functionality that you need? Now, here's something else that most people don't realize. Look, not all of these have to be like full-time W-2 employees in your business. Like if you looked at my accountability chart, you're gonna see that there's certain positions that we outsource, right? Their needs, there is a role, there's a responsibility for that particular seat in the department, right? Specifically when it comes to mine is our marketing department, right? We don't run our own ads anymore, okay? We don't run our own ads anymore. We've got, that's an outsourced seat, right? We've got, right now we've got a project that is redoing all of our analytics and tracking and everything else. And so instead of doing that internally, that is an outsourced seat, okay? So it doesn't mean, the bottom line is this, guys, this is why I want you guys to think about this. It's not about who's on my team, what's the skill set? It's like, dude, what does the business need to succeed according to my vision and the strategy, right? So under the marketing department, what are those seats? Under the sales, look, sales in real estate, look, what do we call that? What do we call that in real estate? What department is that probably?
Okay, hey, I hope you're enjoying this video, and I just wanted to take a second to talk about the importance of having systems in place when you're building a team. Because the worst thing that you can do is hire somebody and you're hiring them into a broken system or into a business where there's no system at all. They show up to work on day one and they don't know what to do and you don't know what they need to do because you have no system in place. And honestly, that's one of the biggest hurdles that newer business owners have or business owners that are hiring for the first time have is their employees show up on day one and they don't know what to do and they don't know what they should be doing. Here at REI BlackBook, we help real estate investors build systems, which makes it way easier to hire because now you can plug new hires into your pre-existing system. If you're interested in learning more about REI BlackBook and you want to give us a try, click the link below this video in the description, sign up for a free trial, and get started with REI BlackBook today.
Acquisitions, right? Acquisitions, so sales is acquisitions. Now, so again, you might have a acquisitions department and a dispositions department. Those may be different, okay? All right, they may be different functionally, all right? So I wanna be clear, so Cherie or Cherry, I'm not sure how to pronounce that. I think Cherie, if I said that right, let me know. If I didn't, then don't let me know. No, I'm just kidding, let me know, for real. Says, hey, I thought strategy and tactics come under the systems leg of the triangle. Look, strategy and tactics definitely are gonna be super important to systems, but systems, look, you've got multiple types of systems, okay? Really three types of systems, okay? You've got management systems, right? You've got management systems. I forget what I call the other one. Dag, it's like totally just draining me. But then you have operational systems, okay? So even though this is the people part of the triangle, this is actually a system. This is gonna be a system inside of the people component, right? So there is some interconnectivity. Just because it's a triangle doesn't mean just because we're hiring people, doesn't mean we don't have strategy and tactics, okay? And specifically, so here's what I want you to think about. Look, right here, look. Each one of these, by the way, each one of these, you're going to, if I look at the triangle again, right, I've got vision, I got people, I got systems. And when we talked about systems, I told you, look, straight up, you're gonna have to identify the systems that you wanna create. And so are we gonna have a marketing system? Yes. So This is kind of how this all is interconnected. Am I working on the people planner? So I'm working on the people planner with my seating chart, but in order to really effectively do this, I have to be clear on the different systems, and marketing system is one. So under marketing, under the marketing system, what am I gonna have? I'm gonna have strategy. What's the marketing strategy? What's the marketing tactics? What's the marketing process? And what are the marketing tools that I'm going to use for this? And based upon the marketing system that I create with strategy, tactics, process, and tools, will then determine the additional seats, that the additional functional seats that I have under the marketing team. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? So you're gonna have different types of systems, right? I'm gonna find the slide because that's gonna drive me crazy. I can't think of it off the top of my head. Why can I not think today? So here's what I want you guys to do. We're gonna take 3 to 5 minutes and draw out your chart and with what you have today. Look, it doesn't have to be perfect. In fact, Liz, I think, already linked up the accountability chart in the seating chart in the chat box. So you can use that to cheat if you want. I would encourage you to take a stab at it first before you go cheat and look at it. So if you already looked at it, it's okay, right? There's no rules. I just like for you to think through this process, right? I know that everybody just wants this, Damon, will you just give it to me? The problem with that is next week, I'm not gonna be there to just give it to you. You have to be able to think through this on your own. That's the part of being an entrepreneur, right? That's part of being a business owner, okay? So go ahead and take 2 to 3 minutes and take your first stab at it. Okay, who would care? Who cares to share and or ask any questions? So raise your hand if you can, if you're willing to share what you came up with. And look, hey, look, I asked you to do this in like 3 minutes. Do I expect you guys to nail this thing? No, I want you to understand the strategy, the process, and you're gonna go back and you're gonna have to do the work, okay? I'm telling you right now, it's gonna be very clear. I'm gonna show you right after lunch, like, hey, look, this is what the next year looks like, and this is probably the most important things you need to do in the next 90 days, okay? So we're gonna talk about that after lunch, okay? So I'm gonna go for about 5 more minutes and then we're gonna break for lunch, okay? Yes. All right, so is it Cherie?
Sherry.
Sherry, okay, all right, cool. So Sherry, all right, what do you have for us?
We kind of only got through a part of it, but we looked at the marketing section and realized that was where we need to generate our leads. So we asked ourselves, where do we want to get our properties from? And so we've made a list of the ways that we want to acquire our, you know, to get property lists. And it was probate, foreclosure auction, drive for dollars, and direct mail.
Okay.
And at this point, we didn't move on into the next thing of, okay, what does that look like? How do we,
yep,
how do we get probate leads? How do we get, you know, direct mail leads, that kind of thing.
But perfect, but you're on the right track. I mean, that's the point of doing this exact thing, right? And you say, okay, what's the marketing system? So I need a marketing system. And in order to define that system, a system consists of 4 things, right? What's the strategy? What's the tactics? What's the strategy? What's the tactics? Then what's the process? And then what are the tools I need? And then that's gonna help you determine the seats on the accountability chart, right? So for instance, you said driving for dollars, okay? So driving for dollars is real easy to jump, and this is where most people this is a mistake that people make, right? Driving for dollars, it's real easy, right? You just start with profit drive, right? So now all of a sudden we start at the bottom and we just go get the tool. No, hold on. What's the strategy, right? What's the overall long-term objective that we're trying to do? Then what's the tactic? What's the actual, define the tactic. And then what's the process? And like, if you do that specifically for driving for dollars, you really think about what's the strategy, what's the tactic, and now let's draw out the process. Let's think about all of the steps that are needed. Now we know how to go implement the tool, right? As opposed to starting with the tool. Quite frankly, look, this is why most people make the mistake with both Profit Drive and REI BlackBook. Like, okay, cool, REI BlackBook said it does a lot of things, let's start there and let's figure out. It's like, well, it's just a tool. Without the strategy, without the tactics, and without the process is defined, it really is difficult. Does that help?
We resemble that remark.
Yeah, trust me, you guys
we dove in and we're like, oh, this is it. Yeah, without any idea where we were going.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And it happens all the time because everybody's like, well, Damon, why can't you just tell us where to start? I'm like, well, man, that's so different for all of you because you're different needs, different direction, different vision. And so that's why it's not as easy as everybody thinks is to just like, hey, just create this blanket cheat sheet of you start here. Now, we do have a basic getting started guide, do these things. We think you get a basic phone number, do some of that stuff for sure. But I want to go back to this so everybody kind of really can hammer this home. And hopefully you guys start to see how all of this starts working together, okay? So if I go back to the triangle, and I know this is hard to read, but it's gonna be more for my visual, and we'll make sure that you guys get this, okay? The triangle, right? We got vision. The vision consists of mission, values, and purpose, right? Mission, values, and purpose. We talked a lot about that. That was the 8 questions, right? How do we get mission, values, and purpose? How do we get that? That is the 8 questions, all right? We talked about that. We went really fast through that on Friday evening. If you feel like it would be beneficial for me to go back over those 8 questions, happy to do that. I can get clarity on the vision part if you guys feel you need to, okay? But that's gonna be definitely part of your first 90 days is you gotta get clarity on the vision, okay? Now the people component, right? We spent a lot of this morning on the people component, determining the right people, right? So the right people, right? The behavior profile, the values, and the skill set, the right seats. Now we gotta know what seats are on the bus. That's right where we're at right now is determining this. But I want you to remember that we talked about systems, okay? There are 3 types of systems, okay? This is the part that I like just totally stumped on, okay, a while ago, I apologize. Right, we got management systems, we got operational systems, and then we got support systems. So really, all of these, you know, our marketing system, our sales system, our ops systems, right? All of that stuff is gonna be really under our operational systems. Those are operational systems. Our support systems are typically gonna fall over here, okay? What does that mean? That means accounting, right? That means accounting, that means your infrastructure, your training, your onboarding, okay? All of that stuff is your support systems, okay? So these are typically your operational systems. And then up here, we gotta have management systems. How are we, in the management system we kind of talked about yesterday, right? That's the, hey look, every year in December, I'm gonna have a 2-day strategy session, so I'm planning out the next year, right? Every 90 days, I'm gonna have a quarterly planning session, but that end of year, I'm gonna say, this is where I'm going for the next 12 months, and this is the things that I need to do. These are the big obstacles that I have in my way, so this is what I'm gonna focus on in the next 90 days, okay? So that's really what we're talking about here is the management systems, okay? So management systems are how am I gonna really manage the business? How am I gonna manage the business? What is the system to do that? And again, what does the system consist of? Strategy, tactics, processes, and tools. Okay, strategy, tactics, processes, and tools. And each one of these are gonna have different systems that you need to define. Not just processes, a process is just a list of tasks, okay? We gotta understand the strategy, the tactics, and then we're gonna use tools for speed and automation, right? We're gonna use tools for speed and automation. I'm telling you, man, this right here, if you guys get this stuff, man, you're ahead of probably 95% of businesses, probably 98-99% of real estate investors, but 95% of businesses in general, okay? So this is kind of where we're at. We did leave the seating chart. We left the link in the chat box so you guys can go take a look at that. But guys, this right here, this is it all coming together. I hope this is making sense. I hope this is starting to click and really starting to trigger some stuff, okay? This is gold. This is gold. I'm telling you. I've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars and even more, probably millions of dollars in mistakes learning this stuff, okay? And my business absolutely has changed so much. And it's not about like, oh my gosh, I've seen explosive growth and all this money came in, you know? Like, we've made a lot of money. We made a lot of money our first year, 2 years, like it was insane, okay? It was insane. But it wasn't fun, it sucked. I didn't enjoy it. This is how taking this approach, and it's still a work in progress. We work on this stuff all the time. This is not like, I don't want you guys to sit here and think, because my staff's probably sitting there saying right now, Damon, man, dude, it sounds great, but like, holy crap. Like, but it's always a work in progress. Like, we're never gonna reach the pinnacle and like, all right, we're done. We got this perfect business. Because it's constantly shifting and changing and things like that. But I promise you, we take this approach and it's a lot more fun. It's a lot more fun, it's a lot more enjoyable. And I firmly believe all of this is why, you know, we've been recognized as one of the best places to work year after year, you know? So give me a hell yeah in the chat box if this is making sense. If you're getting this and you're getting excited about building a business that you absolutely will love, let me know that this is really hitting home and this is making sense for you, okay? So throw it in the chat box. Now here's what we're gonna do, guys. We're gonna go ahead and break for lunch. Okay, yeah, if you got questions, we'll go ahead and here's what we'll do. We'll open up for about 5 minutes of questions, and then we're going to break for lunch, and we're going to take a good hour for lunch. We're going to come back. So here's what I want to talk to you guys about after we come back from lunch, all right? There's so much valuable stuff that we have for you guys. Look, all right, one of the big systems that you need, guess what? Accounting. This is a black hole for most real estate investors that I know. I know this because I bring you in on your power days and I sit down and I say, okay, look, man, you gotta get real with me. Let's look at your financials. Where are you at today? Are you making money? Are you not? How much money are we spending? How much money do you need to live? Like I know you just said you wanna make $1 million, but really what's the purpose of your life, man? Don't you wanna spend time with your family? Like, what's more important to you? Is it building this empire or is it the freedom? And then they always tell me it's the freedom. It's like, okay, well look at this. Like, what's freedom to you? Is it going on vacations with your kids? Is it jumping on an RV? Is it doing whatever the hell you want, whenever you want, being able to travel? Like for me, you know what the definition of financial freedom is? I can leave and I come back and I got more money in my bank account than when I left. That's financial freedom to me. So it empowers me to be able to make decisions that I don't have to think about the money aspect, right? And whenever I do that and I sit down and I talk to you and I say, hey, look, here's the cool thing. I know you wrote down $1 million on your daggum vision statement, but the truth of it is, here's all the things that you said you wanna do. Let's add that up. Oh, wow, you know what, guess what? You could have an amazing life for $250,000 and build a business that you love and have a life that you love. It's not about the money. But guys, look, if you're not doing this stuff, if you don't come in and you have a sit down with me and have a daggum power day or somebody and get some real transparency and some real honesty to that part, then you're gonna be freaking building a damn house with no plan. So I'm gonna go ahead and deliver. You want a brick house? Cool. I'm gonna deliver some bricks and you're just gonna start putting bricks together. You have no damn plan. You don't know where the kitchen's going. You don't know where the bathroom's going. But you know you want $1 million. You may not need $1 million. That's the power of getting clarity on your vision, right? I get a little bit excited about this stuff, okay? I get a little bit excited about this stuff because I've seen the power of it. I've seen so many people change their damn lives, right? Andy Warner said it best yesterday. Look, this will change your life if you let it, okay? All right, so let's open it up for questions. I hope you guys are getting excited about this stuff, all right? I hope you guys get excited about this stuff. Okay? All right, Josephine, what question do you have? How can I help?
Hi, Damon. I got a question. So based on like the chart that you just laid out and even Cherry's sort of feedback there, when you take lead generation sort of as, for example, as a focus point under marketing, would you basically take the approach and say, okay, lead generation, so what's the strategy behind that? What are the tactics behind that specific component of marketing, then the process, essentially how you go about the lead generation and then the tools. And do you essentially then look at this, for example, what Sherry said, auction, direct mail, probate, SEO or driving for dollars as being just one component, one part of like, or basically the tactics of that segment of like just the lead generation as strategy? Yep. Or how do you think of that, like especially for a real estate investor?
Yeah, so great question. And so what I wanna do is, yes, I wanna think about the marketing system, again, strategy, tactics, process, and tools. So I'm gonna think about it, and so part of this, you gotta define the strategy first. And so the strategy, again, we talked about that on Friday, right? That's defining your target, your perfect target customer, what's your value proposition, right? All of that stuff, right? So define that first, get clear, and then you gotta kinda do a little bit of a resource check, meaning, if you remember, I talked about the Madden football game, right? So you look at the team, you're like, hey, their defense is really good. but their offense is bad, their special teams, they're really fast. And so that, so you got to kind of do the self-assessment to say, all right, what's your budget look like? What's your skill set look like? How much time do you have? And then that'll help you determine the tactics. If you've not looked at our motivated seller guide, it actually literally has it outlaid. It says, hey, look, you need a lot of money for this. This is low budget. This is scalable. It kind of gives you that. That's going to help you determine the tactic. We'll link it up in the chat box for sure. Okay?
Okay.
So once you get clear on the strategy, now you start picking tactics. The tactics will then help you define. Once I pick a tactic, and a tactic might be, okay, fine, I'm going to do driving for dollars. Okay, now let's build the process. Once you build the process, that's going to determine the people that you need. That's going to determine the functionality that you need to do that. Does that make sense? And
yeah.
That's going to determine the seats that you need on the marketing team, right? So this takes a work. I mean, guys, I'm not telling you this is going to be like, hey, I'm just going to give you this damn seating chart. You guys are going to run off and be successful because I gave you a chart to copy. If you think about it like I'm explaining it, then you will absolutely have a better, clearer picture. And really, the other powerful part about this is once you do that, then once you do that with every daggum department, think through the systems, think through the processes, then what we want to do is we want to start highlighting the seats that you don't have the skill set. And that's going to help us determine the next hire, right? If we know lead generation is super important, then all right, then you probably need to put, and you're not very good at it, then you probably need to start either outsourcing or hiring people to do that component. But again, every business is different, right? So, you know, we talked a little bit about Kelly, Joe and Kelly's hot seat yesterday, right? They're fast track members, and not every business is gonna be the same. So the seating, their accountability chart is gonna be a little different. Whenever we started talking to Joe and Kelly about all of the things that they need to do as far as the marketing and being able to handle inbound calls and inbound leads and the follow-up and the nurturing, like, I mean, I'm sincere, man. She literally was in tears. Like, she was crying, but she was like, okay, I'll do it. But it's like, wait a minute, there's a better way. So for her, look, her marketing department, like her marketing and sales department, what Joe and Kelly did is they basically said, hey, look, we're not so much worried about this. We're really good at this. Their ops department is really good. They're good at raising capital. They're good at the ops rehabbing and everything else. So they said, hey, look, we're not good at this. So they could have hired somebody to say, look, we're going to build a marketing and sales team to actually start generating off-market deals. Instead, they said, hey, look, they were very clear on the vision. They were very clear on the vision. And they said, you know what? We don't need $1 million. You know, I think it was a couple $100,000. And they're like, okay. In order to live the life that we want, they have three boys. They were going to relocate from New Jersey to San Antonio. And all of that stuff happened in the Power Day, by the way. So all of that stuff happened in the Power Day. Like, hey, we got clear on our vision. We know what kind of money we need to support the vision. All right. So now we put together the strategy and the plan. We know we're really good at this. We're not so good at this. And it's like, okay, well, based upon the money you need, what if we just went directly to wholesalers? What if we went directly to realtors and they started feeding you the deals, right? That now all you need to do is feed them directly into, you know, you got to have a filtering mechanism to analyze the deals, of course, right? But now all of a sudden they took realtors and wholesalers and fed them right into their ops, okay? Because they really need to do less than 10 deals a year. Less than 10 deals a year to lead. So this is all going to be different based upon your vision, right? Based upon your vision. Based upon your resources, based upon where you're at today, that's the power of really doing this stuff, okay? And guys, straight up, I mean, I love diving deep with each of you individually, and that's exactly part of what we do in that Power Day, okay? Is we follow this framework, we follow this process, and I'm gonna cheat a little bit this today because I'm gonna give you guys some of the jumping off points just to get you started. And for those of you guys that are really ready and absolutely serious about your business, then we'll come in and we'll do this directly with you one-on-one, okay?
All right, I hope you enjoyed that video where we taught you how to build a seating chart, build an accountability chart, and make your first one or two key hires. Now, the problem that a lot of investors have, as we talked about, is if you hire team members into a broken system, you're gonna have a broken team. And here at REI BlackBook, we help you build predictable systems that you can plug new employees into, that you can plug your virtual assistant into. They're gonna have their own phone number. They're gonna be able to get in and access their leads from day one. This provides your team with structure and also gives you, as the business owner, complete transparency into what they're doing on a day-to-day basis. So no more wondering what your acquisition managers or disposition managers are doing every day. With a system like REI BlackBook, you're gonna know exactly what they're doing. So if you wanna get started with REI BlackBook, you can click the link below this video in the description, sign up for a free trial, and get started today. And again, if you're new to this channel, make sure that you hit the subscribe button and the bell icon so you get notified every time we release videos just like this. Thanks so much for tuning in today, and we'll see you in the next video.